Hello. We're talking about transfer of title, which if you're working on your salesperson's license, you will probably have 6 or 7 test questions. If you're a broker, you're looking at probably 5 or 6. And this is really going to focus around title insurance, deeds, and again, transferring title from one owner to another. So let's dive on in. First of all, it talks about title insurance and what is insured against. Now, this is a great question. Title insurance is used as a substitute for giving title, transferring title from one owner to a new owner, and being worried that there might be a defect on title. So maybe there's some sort of lien or encumbrance that didn't get cleared up from the old owner that should have in order to transfer it to the new owner. And maybe it comes up in the future. So we put insurance on it so that the new owner has money to cover the situation. So that title insurance insures against future defaults on liens in case there's something imperfected. In Iowa, we still use abstracts to research all those things and attempt to get them all cleared up before transferring title from one party to another. And we do what is called a title search, where we search the current owner, property and owner, to make sure that there hasn't been any new judgments, liens, or any types of encumbrances that have changed or would cause an issue. I think that cloud on title and quiet title for broker owner, this is going to be if there's a gap in ownership. Maybe it says Amy Schaefer owned the property until December 13th. And then I owned it from December 15th on. I've got 2 days there. Who owned it? Well, I probably did a refinance. And the filing or something like there got misrecorded. Something there happened. We got to prove that I was the owner there. And we've got to go on public notice and make sure that I didn't do anything in those 2 days that would create a cloud on title, okay? But that is a very common problem where we've got a break in the chain of ownership between owners, and we got to know who owned that property in those down days, because whoever owned it, did they do anything to create a title issue? Now, the big thing around here is deeds. And the way that we own, let's talk about the definition of the word title. Title is ownership to a property. Phase one is ownership to a property. Phase two is you've got evidence of that ownership. And the evidence that we use is a deed. It's a deed. That shows as the physical evidence. Now, the deed passes from one owner to another when the deed has been delivered and accepted by the buyer, not when the seller or owner signs it, but when it transfers and has been delivered and accepted by the new owner. Now, some types of deeds, there are several. I'm going to focus on 3 for you. I'm going to focus on saying that you need to know what a general warranty deed is, a special warranty deed, and then absolutely, I think you need to know a quit claim deed. A general warranty deed warrants the property from title issues in the past, present, and the owner even warrants the future. Saying, I've done nothing to create a title issue that would create a problem for this future owner. A special warranty deed means that we're warranting the past and the present, but we can't warrant the future. A great time that this is used is for a foreclosure. So the bank has taken the property back from the owner because they know pay and they know stay. They own it and then they go to resell it to the public. They can go and research what's happening present and in the past and clean up the fact that utilities haven't been paid, taxes maybe need, whatever, whatever. They can clear all that up. The problem is they don't know in the future what could pop up. They don't know whether maybe that past owner, before they were foreclosed upon, put on a new roof and didn't pay the contractor, and that roofer in the future may put a lien on the property. So it's special that it warrants pretty much past and present, but not the future. Great, great setup, I think, for an exam question for you. Quick claim deed. If you don't have quick claim deed question on the exam, I'd actually be very surprised. Because I think it's one that is pretty standard. A quit claim deed, not quick claim. I know a lot of us mispronounce it, and sometimes it falls out of my mouth incorrectly as well, but it is a quit claim deed. I want you to think I quit you, divorce me, and get your name off my title. I'm keeping the house. Okay. It is a way to add and remove people to title. In a very simple way. The challenge is it offers no warranty at all whatsoever. So I call my sister and I say, I'm going to quit claim deed you onto my property, sign here. And she's like, heck yeah. I got a stake in your house now. Woohoo. Great. But that means she also steps on to all of the other title issues or encumbrances that may need to be satisfied. Okay. excuse me, because I don't know how to edit my sneezes out. Essential elements of a deed. There are several. Legal competency by both parties. A grantor that is reasonably identified, a statement of consideration, a granting clause, a habendum clause, an accurate legal description, relevant exceptions. Maybe they're reserving subsurface rights. We talked about that with the Beverly Hillbillies. Acknowledgement, which is notarization, and delivery and acceptance. You got a long list. I'm going to focus on three. This legal competency by the grantor, we've talked about this already, is a void and voidable situation. But again, if it's someone that's duress, mental incompetency, or a minor, it's voidable. It's only void if they were only already declared mentally incompetent in a court of law. I can't just come and say, what, I sold my house, I want it back, guys. I didn't know what I was doing. I just lost my husband. I had a back surgery and I was on massive doses of OxyContin and I was washing it down with Jack Daniels. And my kids pressured me and told me that they couldn't, that I couldn't handle the property by myself and that they would each take a $10,000 gift check when I got my proceeds. They just wanted my money. Those things may all be true. And you really maybe had not had the mental capacity to be signing a contract, but you're going to have to go in front of a court of law to really, truly decide that. So it's voidable, voidable. The second one I'm going to highlight from that list is acknowledgement of the signature, which is notarization. By the way, if you're not a notary, become a notary. Put that on your list of things to do. And that means you existing agents too, because I know a few of you rely on the graciousness of others, or maybe you've got a transaction coordinator. I'm gonna recommend you become a notary. Go to sos.iowa.gov, sos.iowa.gov. That's the Secretary of State. You can notarize your seller signatures, for their deeds, if that's something that you're responsible for doing at your brokerage. Very common for you to do that. I just want to highlight that the deed is what needs to be notarized, not the purchase agreement, not agency agreements, not listing contracts, not exclusive buyer, agency agreements. No, that it's the deed that needs notarized. The deed is the one that needs notarized. And we talked about this a little bit already, is that it's got to be delivered and accepted. It's not the date or the day that the seller signs it. It's when it's been delivered and accepted by the buyer. Okay. Now, this talks about the importance of recording. And this is what they call constructive notice, I believe is maybe a term that I've not personally seen maybe when I've audited the exam, but I know it's a term that's out there if you're using other platforms to study. How dare you cheat on me, but whatever, I get it. Just kidding. The importance of recording is you want the public to know who owns this property because it really helps prevent in fraud. However, let's say I sign the deed and you as the buyer accept it, and for some reason it doesn't get recorded. That doesn't mean that there's a flaw on title, and it doesn't mean that the transfer didn't happen. It just means that there's been no notice that it's happened. So you do want those things recorded. Because especially, for example, if you get a loan on a property, and for you existing agents that are maybe studying with me, the lender is only going to loan money on a property where they are the first lien. So they want recorded ASAP. They don't want to give the buyer the opportunity to go out and create a situation where other liens are put on the property in front of theirs. Because then when it comes to priority, they might be second or third in line. They don't want to be second or third in line. They want to be first in line. So if the borrower defaults, now, according to the mortgage, they have the right to proceed with foreclosure. So here's an example. We, for some reason, one of our counties here in central Iowa is going to be closed for a few days. And I think President's Day maybe is playing into this a little bit, but they're going to be closed, it sounds like, for four business days, and it's created total havoc. And here's the problem. Here's why it's a problem. Can you still close? Yes. Does that mean that title didn't, the buyer accepted the deed? Does that mean it didn't happen? No, it means it did happen. It's the lender that's got a problem with it. They want that recorded ASAP. So they don't want you to close on Thursday when the recorder's office is closed and have to wait until next Tuesday, because you've got, what, 5 or 6 days there that your borrower could go out and do something that would create a lien that would jump before theirs. And again, the bank doesn't want that. So that's why when you can't close on holidays, like national holidays, when those government entities are going to be closed, because the lender wants it recorded right away. And even if it was cash, you want that recorded and given notice to the world that you now own it. That way the former owner can't try to sell it to someone else under the table and create a fraudulent issue. Because trust me, that's happened before back in the wild, wild west days of real estate. Now, escrow closings, here's what happens, is we go to an escrow company, which might be a title company or an attorney. We use their escrow company or their escrow account to pull in all the funds. So an amount gets wired from the lender. The buyer brings in their down payment and any costs that maybe they would owe to the bank for originating their loan or any closing costs. We've got this bulk amount of money. And from that bulk, this escrow company is going to start cutting checks. they're going to cut a check to the seller's current lender and pay off their mortgage for that alienation clause to be met. Broker fees are going to get paid. Taxes are probably going to be addressed. All these bills start getting paid on behalf of the seller so that we know they get paid. And then if there's anything left, that's what the seller gets as proceeds. Every once in a while, we've got sellers have got to bring money in to make those figures whole. Okay. So that's what the escrow agent is doing. And sometimes we've got prorated items that the seller paid for at the beginning of the year, but now they sell it in June. And the buyer owes them credit from July to December for the time they took over ownership. Okay. And then this is just really a good list of the things that are going to be on that closing disclosure. But I would look for the terms prorated and accrued. Prorated means the seller paid the bill the beginning of the year. So the seller owes the buyer, the buyer owes the seller a credit. Accrued items means the bill is going to get paid after closing. So the seller owes a credit to the buyer for the time they owned the property, but the bill isn't due yet. And just as an example, in Iowa, we pay taxes in arrears. So if I, March 2020, for example, we paid taxes for when we owned the property January through July of 2019. The tax bill was due in March of 2020. Now in March of 2021, we're going to be paying for the time that we owned our property is January through June of 2020. So we're always paying things in arrears. So we owe a credit to the buyer for the time that we own the property, but the taxes are not due yet. That's accrued. Prepaid would be if we paid it in advance. Okay. As an example, I would know the terms foreclosure and short sale. Again, foreclosure is when the bank has taken the property back from the homeowner. Short sale is when the owner still owns the property. We're asking the bank to sell it short on funds. It's not short on time. It's short on funds. So for example, I maybe owe the bank $150,000, but now the property is only worth $130,000. We're asking the bank to forgive that $20,000. And I believe I've seen someone mention a question that might revolve around, does the person that's forgiven that $20,000, do they get a 1099 that they've got to pay tax on it? And the answer is no. There was actually government policy written, I think during Obama era, that said, no, they don't have to pay taxes on that forgiven amount. Okay, that wraps up transfer of title. We'll see you soon.